Good morning, everyone. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our inaugural Micro-symposium on leadership in the new era. As we were just, this is an exciting day. It's an exciting day for lots of reasons. This is a time where the students get to showcase their projects that they've been working so hard on, and it's a chance where we get to show the chairman of our institute what we've been up to for the last semester. So my name is Nancy Stout. I'm a professor in the law school and a professor in the Price School of Public Policy, and most importantly, I'm the academic director of the Schwarzenegger Institute for State and Global Policy. Before we begin, I want to introduce a few of our special guests here. We have Professor Arnold Schwarzenegger, the chairman of the Institute. We're so excited to have you come. We've been talking about this for months, right, everybody up there, all the students? Bonnie Reese, the global director of the Schwarzenegger Institute. We have Jack Knott, the dean of the Price School of Public Policy. Scattered throughout, we have faculty members, deans, good friends, even back from the weightlifting days, I understand. I've seen pictures of some of the audience members who are pretty amazing. So I wanted to give you a few details about what today's event is about. Today's event grows out of a class that I've been teaching called, Leadership for a Postpartisan Age. And this is a class where what we've tried to do is learn how to think about social and political issues from a postpartisan perspective. So what does that mean? A postpartisan perspective is one where we all come together as teams and as collaborators to talk about the important issues of the day, not in a hyper-partisan way, a way that we've seen unfold in lots of different contexts in the recent election, and so on and so forth. Now, many of you probably know that this class is taking cues from Professor Schwarzenegger when he was a governor. He was very actively promoting a postpartisan approach to politics, and this is what we're trying to do in the classroom, engage in a more postpartisan, friendly, and collaborative way. The students haven't just been talking about political issues and social issues. They've been learning how to be leaders. These students don't want to be followers or mere consumers of social and political ideas and thoughts. What they care about is being the nation's leaders, the global's leaders, in the new age. So today, what you're going to see is the incredible results of an incredibly long semester of very hard work. Some of the work has been exhilarating, but other components of the work, as the students know, has been frustrating and maddening. Putting together these videos, putting together these social media projects, and unfolding these campaigns has been quite a lot of work. And right now, I just want to give an applause to the 13 students who pulled this off. One thing I can say about today is it's going to showcase how awesome USC is. And even more importantly, it's going to demonstrate why our students routinely go out and be the nation's and the globe's leaders. These projects are so fundamentally, for me, life-changing in what I can expect from students now. So all of you who are going to maybe take a class in the near future, I've been meeting friends, now the expectations are raised. So I'll turn now to the videos. I know that after you see these videos, you'll probably have some questions and answer, some questions, which as students I hope will have answers. So we'll wait for questions and answers until after all six of the projects have been presented. And then after the Q&A period, I'll invite Professor Schwarzenegger up to close the proceedings and hopefully shake each of the students' hands. So I'd like to start with our first project. Our first project is going to be presented by Sydney Allen and Mitchell Vieira. Sydney and Mitchell, like the rest of us, know that after-school programs have started to be cut. So what have Sydney and Mitchell done? They have literally gone out and started an after-school program on their own. They've held after-school classes, they've taught yoga, they've done a lot of things that you're going to be shocked by. The project has gotten so popular that not only students in and around USC want to participate, but actually students from all over LA want to keep this project going in the new year, keep this after-school program going. It's a program that started in the Hoover Recreation Center, not more than a mile away from USC. So Mitchell and Sydney.
Good morning. My name is Sydney Allen, and this is my partner, Mitchell Vieira. And this is Give a Voice LA.
Morning, everyone. Arts and culture are dying subjects in today's public school system. With massive budget cuts at the federal, state, and local levels, the extracurricular subjects such as art, health, and culture, well, they're the ones that are cut first. Now, Give a Voice LA doesn't simply say fight for funding. Instead, Give a Voice LA challenges the community to step forward and give a voice to those children to fill a void where only 15% of children are enrolled in after-school programming. And of those not enrolled, over 26% are without any supervision. The community needs to come forward and give a voice to children who do not have the resources to express their own. Whether it be the ability to share through performing arts and dance, or the chance to reflect on meditation and yoga, or the opportunity to feel and connect through new forms of music and sound, the discovery of new ways to live a healthy life, or the fundamental understanding of all cultures around us and how we interact as one in this great world.
We now ask you to join us. Will you give a voice?
Give a voice, LA.
You guys walk through the door and introduce your program, which is totally in line with what we want to offer here. I thought, well, maybe, you know, something fresh and different they would embrace, the community would embrace them. And, you know, I watch how you work with the children. It was excellent. They love you. They embrace what you have to offer.
Give a Voice LA is a social media campaign to build community-driven after-school programs in healthy living and the arts. Give a Voice LA seeks to encourage dialogue among members in the greater Los Angeles area and throughout the United States, in the hopes of inspiring others to implement and volunteer at their local community centers. In order to accomplish this, we developed a 5-week after-school program at Hoover Recreation Center in Los Angeles. Each week, we concentrated on a specific pillar that we believe is a necessary skill for the youth living in today's society. Share, reflect, feel, discover, understand. These are the pillars of success.
Delicious. yoga because I learned how to do new stretches to calm myself down.
I like doing jumps because that was something new that I've done.
What I like the most is cooking.
I like to come to after school because it's fun, I get to meet new people, and because I get to do new things every day.
All of them, including my daughter, their personalities have changed, they have more confidence, they're able to communicate with you, you know, intellectually, and they just don't have any fear of.
The project was really exciting, and I myself have benefited from after-school programming, and it taught me and helped me learn to develop skills I didn't know I had. And I also learned that I love to do things like cooking and baking, and I think that's why I wanted to teach somebody else, maybe to share my passions.
The kids, they need this. They need this as a part of their vehicle to thrive, not only with academics, but culture. They need this.
Give a voice, LA.
Give a voice, LA.
Give a voice, LA.
Give a voice, LA.
No, Eddie.
Give a voice, LA.
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 Give a voice, LA. As you can see, many have already pledged to give a voice. This January will be the first of our two after-school program cycles.
Through sharing,
reflecting,
feeling,
discovering,
and understanding,
we work to give a voice.
Please join us.
Give a voice, LA.
Our next project will be presented by Tanya Mercado and Chris Daskalos. Tanya and Chris have determined that through study and investigation, have determined that being smart, being hardworking is very important, but in order to be a great leader, you have to do a little bit more. They'll tell you about what that little bit more is now. Tanya and Chris.
Thank you, Dr. Stout. Thank you, everybody, for coming. First of all, family, friends, Dean Knott, Professor Schwarzenegger, and Bonnie. Thank you, guys, and all our friends at the Price School. We really, really appreciate you guys coming. We all came to USD to make a difference. We all know about the great education that we have to offer here. We want to land that great job. Who knows? Maybe somebody in this room will be the next governor of California. But throughout, throughout the semester, Chris and I have done research on student life. We know what it's like to have an internship, a job, 16 units, and we have found that a key to great leadership is fitness.
As students, we're all busy learning through lectures, homeworks, and projects. But guess what? All of that knowledge isn't going to be enough. Because to be a competitive player in the arena of our nation's best leaders, it takes more than just knowledge. It literally takes physical fitness. Fitness, you can make that last meeting when you thought your day was already done. Fitness, you can overcome jet lag twice in 1 week. Fitness, so that you can work harder than the next person that knows just as much as you do. That's why, over the course of this semester, Tanya and I have been looking to students on campus to see how they stay fit to stay successful. And we've even gone as far as creating our own fitness events to urge more students to join our cause. And now, we're taking our story to the limitless boundaries of social media, because we want the world to know that staying fit is important to staying successful. Thank you, and enjoy the video.
Thank you.
Our third project will be presented by Chelsea Wood and Andrew Christopher. Chelsea and Andrew have conducted a study of food options in South Central LA, and here are their findings presented in their project, their video.
After a long day of work or school, sometimes the easiest and fastest dinner option is to go through drive-thru. In this way, Americans are taking the easy and unhealthy way out.
Over the past several months, as we've conducted research, we've found some alarming statistics. Statistics like over one-third of residents in South Los Angeles are considered obese.
My name is Chelsea, and this is my partner, Andrew, and together we are Feed South Central. Our campaign started as a mission to encourage South Los Angeles residents to eat, shop, and live healthy. We see the food environment in South Los Angeles as a case study for improving the food environment across the nation.
Over the past several months, our goals have been to develop interactive tools to allow the community to do things like rate their local markets and grocery stores to find the most healthy options. We've interviewed experts in the social media realm, as well as community leaders and organizers to get their take on the issues that are on the ground. Through these tools, we have given people in the community real, meaningful information to make the healthiest choices.
And through community health education, our ultimate mission is to change the perception as America from a fast food nation to a fresh food nation. So tonight, when you're deciding what to feed your families, don't take the easy and unhealthy way out. We now invite you to use our tools and our presentation to go back to your neighborhoods and improve the food environments there. Thank you.
Food is not discretionary. You have to eat.
Have the issues of diabetes, hypertension, childhood obesity, morbid obesity.
Money in targeting children.
Now an area that has an overabundance of fast food restaurants.
There's more Taco Bells, there's more KFCs. Have the time to make a huge meal for your family. You just want to get things on the go.
Those are the problems. How can we find solutions?
Sabha and Karina really love public art, so they started documenting murals in and around LA. Then they discovered that the city of LA was trying to close down public artists. So they actually went to City Hall, spoke up at City Hall, trying to protect the public art that's out there. So here's the story of their project. Sabha and Karina.
Thank you, Professor Stout. Thank you to everyone who's here today. I invite you all to imagine with me. Imagine you have a story to tell. Imagine you don't have the words to express it. Imagine you don't know what to say. Imagine someone tells you that your story is not important. Imagine someone tells you that they don't want to hear it. Imagine someone denies you your only means of telling it.
Some people,
don't have the platform they need to tell their stories. Their voices are lost. Their stories are not told. Murals are for everyone. Murals are a community's visual history book. Murals keep the past alive.
We at Mural Project LA have gone to City Council, we have met with mural preservation groups, and we have engaged people through social media, all in an effort to ensure that murals are given the value that they deserve. You see, language is exclusive. Art is for everyone. Murals are universal. Everyone deserves to tell their story. We all have stories. We are all part of communities. Through working with policy and through our appreciation of art and the stories that are around us, we can ensure that murals are given the value that they deserve. My name is Sabha Salama, and this is Karina Casillas, and we are Mural Project LA. We invite you to listen and to watch our story. Thank you.
Realizing the future of murals was at stake due to a mural ordinance, we formed Mural Project LA. Our intention is to raise awareness of the importance of murals to those who haven't realized their value.
Without murals, adolescents find other ways to express their creativity, usually through vandalism. There are even several programs that focus on encouraging former criminals to participate in painting murals.
Processes like mural, the ideas that best work to bring people together, to give everyone a chance to add something, an insight, a story. In particular, when we're talking about cultural education, gender education, creating cohesion in the social fabric, these are reasons why everyone can benefit from caring about things like a mural ordinance.
Capital of the world. Let's appreciate the stories around us.
Kalia Song and Shouju Wang, our fifth presenters, our fifth group. Kalia and Shouju are from China, and what they know, like the rest of us, know that the superpowers are engaged in hostilities and quite a bit of friction. What they believe is the answer to the problems that currently lie with the two superpowers is the next generation, with them, the global leaders who will change this and create a more friendly, post-partisan way of engaging on the global stage.
Thank you, Professor. Four months ago, we left from China, flew across the Pacific Ocean, covered 10,000 miles, and finally arrived at a completely different land, the United States. We became two of the 200,000 Chinese students studying in the United States. My name is Ke Le.
My name is Xiu Zhi. You may wonder how much energy and power two young ladies can release to the society. You may wonder how much work two of us can accomplish within 4 months. You may wonder how much impact we can make on US-China relations.
Today, we want to tell you how the younger generation's innovative ideas can make a big difference on the global stage. We would like to present our leadership project, SAIL. SAIL, Study Abroad to Achieve International Leadership.
After traveling for miles, we felt two world powers, US and China, suffer from a lot of misunderstandings and misconnections. This is why we want to start our leadership project. We aim to ameliorate US-China frictions through frequent and in-depth communications between university students, who will be the future leaders in both nations. We advocate for effective and continuous talks on US-China controversial topics. We aim to cultivate future leaders with global vision and profound understandings in both nations' history, culture, and social norm.
In the past several months, we hosted roundtable discussions, social impact activities, and simulated negotiations to enhance understandings between American and Chinese students. We are now expanding our projects in universities in California, and more universities outside California will join us in the future.
Please enjoy our video. Thank you.
China has a different political system than we do. China's at a different stage of development than we are. We come from very different cultures.
A Chinese communist newspaper has told Washington to shut up. They also said stop meddling in their business.
Why, for example, Beijing distrusts Washington? What does Washington do that triggers this kind of response in Beijing? On each side, it's not just an emotion. It's an analysis that leads them to that conclusion, and neither side understands the other side.
The hope of the relationship is to patiently wait until 2020s, maybe even the 2030s, when people of your age go back to China and assume leadership positions, and people who are American, who are right now studying in China, studying Chinese, learning, traveling throughout the country, meeting all kinds of people, learning all kinds of things, come back to the United States and assume positions of leadership.
Chinese students is disjointed.
No very deep topic to talk about.
We mostly only interacted through our classwork.
It felt so much easier to hang out with Chinese students.
Big gaps in knowledge.
Language barrier.
Different cultural background.
Most of us are not fully prepared.
It's very hard for us to actually learn from each other.
Maybe we should open up our borders more frequently and let more people just talk to each other, the people from different cultural and racial backgrounds just talk to each other plainly and, you know, exchange ideas. After that, we'll have a better understanding, I mean, on both sides.
We'll be right back.
think this project provides us a very, very precious opportunity to immerse ourselves into a different group of people.
Hearing about the SAIL project from USC, I think that's something that we all should do, to provide this platform for students, both American students and the Chinese international students studying here, to have a free discussion of different opinions and perspectives.
I believe more talks between us
can make a huge difference.
Morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming and supporting us. I know our whole class really appreciates it. As members of the USC community, you may have found yourself walking around campus and wondering why basic issues still exist, such as the lack of a fall break or the alarming number of broken sidewalks on the street. Around Los Angeles, you may have found yourself questioning why is the traffic so bad, or bemoaning the lack of good public transportation.
As a global citizen, do you wonder why climate change hasn't been resolved? Or as the Kony 2012 campaign reminded us, why Joseph Kony hasn't been caught after 26 years of war. Now ask yourself, what have you done about it? Too busy? What can one person really do?
As future leaders in an ever-changing world, we need to start asking ourselves why we don't get up and take action about causes that we find important, be it something as global as climate change or as local as bike safety around USC.
My name is Gabriella Hecht, and these are my partners, Patrick Elder and Kristen Hernandez. And over the course of the semester, our project has looked at this lack of initiative through the lens of a problem that affects USC students every day on campus: the large number of bikes and the steps the university and the city are taking to alleviate the struggles that accompany this highly popular method of transportation.
While we chose to channel our passion into researching the implementation of bike lanes around USC, we hope that our project can serve as a larger call for action.
We hope that you enjoy our presentation, and we challenge you to ask yourselves, what will you fight for?
Get ready. What's your little gun? Silent indifference, hunger for vengeance, or words from a wicked tongue. People get ready. Only you can choose what you will do when it comes down to you.
The fact that people place more value on sports over the arts.
I find it really wrong that UCLA won't let us stab like right in the middle of the football field.
I wish teachers' unions were more willing to embrace educational reform.
It really bothers me when people use the R word.
Even people shove their trash in the small recycle bins being just for bottles.
I think to me it's the prejudices within our society.
I'm mad that Romney lost the election.
I've been going to elementary schools nearby and donating my time and teaching them theater and theater games and how to express themselves. If I'd done anything, ooh, I guess I haven't.
No.
I mean, I haven't done anything personally, but I mean, at least the school should do something, right?
But unfortunately, I don't have the political power to get involved with teachers' unions.
And I'm not even registered to vote.
What's your little gun? Silent indifference, hunger for vengeance.
Biking is a large part of the transportation culture at USC. And after experiencing the ups and downs, the quick rides to class, and the near collisions ourselves, we decided to fight for improved bike safety on and around campus.
Oh, my.
With this in mind, we developed Bike Scafely, an initiative to better understand bike safety and lobby for its improvement. We wanted to know more about the current state of bike safety, so we dug deep into the subject. What are we fighting for?
Hired some a bike consulting firm to come in and look at the university's infrastructure and make recommendations for how to be both a pedestrian and bicycle-friendly campus. As a result, they made some recommendations. Those recommendations are massive infrastructure changes to the university that cannot be accomplished in 1 minute. And so the first thing was to see if an experimental bike lane on Truesdale would actually work.
The university is aware of and committed to improving bike safety and promoting a culture of respect amongst the Trojan family. However, after over 40 hours of research, interviews, and collecting data, we realized our project was about more than fighting for bike safety.
While the initial goal was to increase bike lanes, our experience helped us affirm the importance of being leaders in our community by taking initiative on an issue we care about and inspiring others to do the same. Hatred and violence, millions fall silent, don't even hear their cries. It's time to love one another, we're sisters and brothers. What are we fighting for? Too many bags that are breaking, lives being taken. What are we killing for? I think it's time for forgiveness to rise up in this. What are we waiting for? Love to teach us the way to overcome.
The university has already committed to improving the issue of bike safety, but there are so many other issues that people only talk about and never act upon.
If you care about an issue, go do something about it.
Start that nonprofit you've always dreamed about.
Volunteer for that cause you've always cared about.
Research a problem that you are concerned about.
It's up to you.
What are you waiting for?
What will you fight for?
What will you fight for?
What will you fight for?
We have a few minutes of questions and answers. If people had questions about the projects, where they're going to go, how'd they learn these incredible skill sets, we'd give you a chance to ask our presenter anything that you want to ask. So Amanda, I know you have a question.
Oh, sure. So, thank you, Nancy. I know Give a Voice LA mentioned that you will be continuing your project next semester with a second term of after school program activities. I was wondering if any of you also plan or hope to continue the work of your project after this class is completed.
So do any of you have future projects in mind, either on the specific project that you're working on or?
Hello again, everyone. So actually, Karina and I, with Mural Project LA, we've, like we mentioned in the video, we've spoken with Mural preservation groups, and we've already been in contact with some of them, and they're actually handing over some of their research of the mural documentation that they've done in the past, and so we can then post that information online and then hopefully see what progress has been made on murals, because some murals are gone after 10 years, for example. Some have been painted over, some are diminishing. So we do have that plethora of work that we'll be able to work for. As well as our Instagram account. If we're actually documenting murals on Instagram, so people are sending us their pictures of murals around LA and we're posting them online. And so we have a little bit of a database on our own for geographical reference.
We actually, it was all trial and error. Some of us had a little bit more help. We had a specific helper who's actually specializes in that. But other than that, we spent weeks vetting. We made the videos, we'd come back, people said they hated them, we would go and fix them. We'd come back, they said, we kind of like them now, fix them again. And so just that process, got the final product to where it was, but it was definitely trial and error. And it's a great skill to have now. I know we're all gonna take it with us and it's awesome.
We have stories.
I think the most valuable, one of the most valuable parts of this class has actually been teaching ourselves how to do things, kind of going along the way. None of us are any film students or formal filmmaking experience. And so thanks to iMovie, which is a great program, but you still have to teach yourself a lot. And so that was definitely an experience, but it was really valuable. And like they mentioned, we'll take all of that knowledge into the future. And same goes for social media. None of us had any formal web design training or anything. So teaching ourselves along the way not only taught us those skills in those areas, but also in general, sort of how to teach ourselves things in any field in the future.
We've learned that you can actually do a lot of these weeks of after-school programming with little to no funding. I mean, the theater exercises, the yoga and classes, they already have the yoga mats there. They have the kitchen there. We spent probably under $100 to do all 5 weeks. And Cindy and I paid part of it. A couple of our volunteers paid part of it when they came in. So that part of it, I think, is manageable. I mean, of course, if we had additional funding, we'd be able to do bigger things, more sites, perhaps. The other thing is getting the community to respond so they send their kids. And I think that's another whole part of it. And what we've been trying to do is reach out to the parents. We spent our Halloween out at the Hoover Recreation Center. There's a lot of parents that bring their kids there for trick-or-treating. We talked to a lot of them. A lot of them only speak Spanish. So we were able to, I practiced my Spanish a little bit, Grandma. and from there, just really trying to get out there on the grassroots level and talk to these parents, because sometimes that's the only way. Next week, there's a big Christmas celebration where some of the children will be going to get toys for tots, and there'll be a lot of parents that night. I'll be going myself as Santa Claus. And I will be, at the same time, bringing others with me to kind of promote that end. So I think that's the two part. As far as additional funding, we have, things like this video that we can show and show what's the effect. We have statements from the people that work at these centers and the children that have gone through our programs. We really try to document everything we do so that we can show what the effect is afterwards.
So I had the opportunity to work with Give a Voice LA, and it was amazing, and I got to do a cooking class, but the kitchen had nothing. So luckily I was able to bring stuff. So to fill in that funding void, we haven't talked about details, but to do a drive for the kitchen to get anything and everything that you would need. And I'm really involved with my church. I'm gonna use my church as a mechanism to gain all these items. So I think just on the grassroots level, we can get everything that we need to fill these community centers and to teach these children. And the community center already has so many things. They have yoga mats, right? Like really random things. And it's just getting the people that know how to use these items and putting them to use to teach good lessons and to inspire children to go out and make something of themselves.
First of all, really great. Everyone did such wonderful presentations. Congratulations to all of you. This time is on the mural project, because not only were you advocates for it, but you actually tried to influence a political vote on that. So my question is, in doing that, did you reach out and collaborate, and if so, how, with the other advocates? Did you have any individual meetings with the city council members And what was the final vote? Was it close? Was it unanimous? So that's kind of my question concerning how the advocacy went on the politics.
So in attending City Hall, we first, the process was not one that was very easy. It was quite unique because within policy, there was always last minute scheduling changes. There was, I know we were scheduled in for one City Hall meeting on a Thursday at 8, and then it ended up getting rescheduled to like a week or two after. Throughout the process, then we did our own research both on the murals we had seen in our cities. There are a lot of murals just right around the corridor, right around the area. And we met up during and after the City Hall presentation meeting with SPARC, which is a muralist organization that specifically talks about reuniting the spark of art within our communities. For example, they've taken a rundown jail and turned it into a beautiful, amazing gallery, something that's not quite seen often. It's very unique in itself and specific to LA. In Venice, of course, if you guys want to go ahead and take a look at that. They're always open to the community and anybody who's willing to take a part in that. And then throughout our process, we've continued mainly the communication with SPARC, one of their main muralists, Judy Baca, who's donated a few of her murals. There's, if you guys have time after this presentation, she has a mural here in this building on the fourth floor. Feel free to take a look at that. And we've maintained contact with them. As we said, we will continue this process of maintaining communication so that the community is aware about these murals. Because most oftentimes, these murals are in areas that aren't in public places. Like, they're out in the open, but say they're as you're on your train on a train ride to work, it's something that you pass by that you like see maybe like second glimpse of it. I know one of our like class members mentioned that there's an Obama mural that he sees only on the way to work from the train. He only gets 5 seconds glimpse of it, but every time he gets to see it, he talks about how inspiring it is because he knows all the history behind that mural, like all the history of what it took Obama, you know, to become president, you know, for his second term. And seeing that for him, just, it brings back so much that he says, if that thing were to be painted over, he really wouldn't know when else he would take the few seconds to think about such an issue that really does affect all of us.
First of all, let me just say thank you to Chuck Knapp for being such a great partner and such a great leader in this school here. I mean, without you, we wouldn't be able to do that. And you're the real deal, because you go all over the world and you lecture. We just talked about the great lecture you've given to Chinese leaders over there and all over the world, and so I love our relationship, so thank you very much for making this. Professor Nancy Stout, I want to thank her. She was a big believer in this institute right from the beginning, and she was like passionate about it. Bonnie Reese, our global director, of course, you know, she has been with me for 20 years. Thank you for your great work, Bonnie. I really appreciate that. And now we
I'll read off each of the students' names, and then the governor has a special gift for each student.
And as they're read off, each student comes up, gets it, and there'll be a photograph taken of you. Yeah.
Start with Sydney Allen.
Arnold.
Thank you.
Soju Wong. Kelsey Wood.
Now we're going to have one group shot.
Yeah, one group shot, okay.
And we'd like to also ask the parents that came, were able to come here today to support the students, to please stand.